Schön, dass wir hier jemanden zu Besuch haben, auf den ich mich lange gefreut habe. Wir haben zu Gast bei uns Rich Roll und Julie Pyatt, Autor von Finding Ultra Rich Roll and Julie Pyatt with his wife together. Mit seiner Frau hat er das Plant Power Cookbook veröffentlicht. Das stellen Sie jetzt aktuell hier vor auf der Frankfurter Buchmesse und wir haben Sie jetzt hier zu Gast. So, Rich and Julie, thanks for being here. Thanks for joining us.
Thank you.
So much welcome here.
Thanks for having us.
You just released your book, The Plant Power Way, that we can show you here into the camera. That's a big, huge cookbook, and I really must give you a compliment. It's you can really feel that there's so much soul in it, and I really like that book. So thanks for this contribution to the book market, the vegan book market.
Thank you.
And it was just released in German, but before we talk about it, I would like to ask you to introduce yourself in a few words. Probably we start with you, Julie.
Yeah, so I'm a mother of four children, and also a musician and an artist, and I'm a vegan chef and wife to this ultra-endurance athlete, author Rich.
Yeah, so I'm an ultra endurance triathlete, and I'm a wellness advocate, a plant-based nutrition advocate. I do a lot of public speaking. I'm a podcast host and, of course, an author and also a parent to four children and wife or husband to this beautiful woman, Julie, here.
Yeah, so, okay, thanks a lot. And could you give us a brief overview of what the new book is about and what were your goals with it?
Mm-hmm. So The Plant Power Way is essentially a cookbook. It's 120 plus plant-based recipes that are oriented around the family. I, as an athlete, am interested in the foods that are gonna fuel me and power me through my workouts. So there's plenty of recipes that address that. But also everything in there is meant to please even the most finicky, carnivorous members of your family. And in addition to that, it's really a lifestyle guide. It's a book for everybody who's interested in just getting healthier and eating more, as we like to say, plant-powered, incorporating more plant-based foods into your daily life with lots of tools and resources about how to do that.
Yeah, so how it was working together as a couple, or yeah, even as a family. It wasn't only you who contributed to the book, it was also your family, your sons and your daughters. Mm-hmm. How did it feel to work together on everything like this?
Well, we live a very creative life together, so we're used to working together. That being said, Rich has his strengths and I have my strengths. So I am the chef and I created all the recipes. Rich is more into the science of how the body works and the nutrients and, you know, what are the perfect combinations. So we make a good team.
Yeah, but it was definitely a collaborative effort. Everybody in the family participated in putting this book together. You know, my first book, Finding Ultra, was really my personal story of finding plant-based nutrition and how that repaired my health and fueled me to all of these, you know, sort of athletic accomplishments that I achieved. And the Plant Power Way really picks up where Finding Ultra leaves off by telling our family story, how Julie and I make it work as a couple and as parents and how we're raising our children to be plant-powered.
You give pretty much a close insight to your family in the book with all these pictures at your home place. Mm-hmm. One is a little bit like, oh, should we really show everybody how we live together and how we are living together? Yeah.
Well, I mean, I think it was our intention from the beginning. If you came and visited us in Malibu, you would probably come. We would make some smoothies. There would be a lot of children running around the house, maybe somebody painting. Then we would make you a beautiful plant-based meal, and then we would probably sing for you or some music.
You're coming.
And, you know,
first
Rich,
we go for a run.
Yeah, you know? Rich, cool. Yeah, Rich would be fresh and off the trails from running. And so the intention with this cookbook was really to shoot the lifestyle photography in an editorial type way so that when you read the book, we wanted the reader to feel as if we had invited the reader into our home and had saved them a spot at our family table.
Oh, great. It worked. So great. So, Julie, what is it like to live together with a guy who spent hours on the road and training and obviously needs a special nutrition to perform the way he does? So, you are a very creative person, not only a musician and I'm doing meditation and yoga teacher, I think, but you seem to be also very creative in the kitchen with all your recipes. So what are you concentrating on when you're doing recipes for Rich?
Well, I mean, this book came about really from an authentic desire to feed him and fuel him and support him in his very long training sessions. So just as his wife and someone who loves him, I felt that I had a skill and that I could create meals that would be really rejuvenating to his body and repair his body so that he could get out the next day and repeat the same training. At the same time, I have four children, some of which are older boys in their 20s, and I wanted to create real food that is warm and nurturing and really satiates you and makes you feel like you ate well. So it was really that desire, and I used my creative talents, and that's what resulted in all these recipes.
Are you creative in the kitchen as well, or is it not one of your passions?
My creativity in the kitchen's a little bit different. Like when I make a smoothie, I'm focused on what are the nutrients that I need for my body, and I don't care so much about taste. So whatever it is, I eat it. Julie is the one who will take that and then and then make it taste delicious for everyone else. So.
Yeah, I just know that my wife doesn't like my smoothies at all because they taste awful.
Yeah.
So. Yeah. All right. When I went vegan 3.5 years ago, I think for the first time in my life, I started to inform myself about what I'm really eating there. So it was one of the best decisions in my life. We talked about that earlier. And that's one of the things I really like about it. But I think you get a different relationship, not only to food, but also to your body. And how do you feel about that?
Yeah, for sure. Food truly is medicine, as Hippocrates said so many eons ago. And I think we probably all heard that as school children. But how many of us have actually stopped and really pondered that or really put that to the test? And it really is true. When you shift the vibration or the quality of the foods that you're eating, not only will that affect you physically in terms of eating plant-based, you can prevent and actually even reverse all these lifestyle diseases like diabetes and obesity and heart disease that too many people are suffering from. But it's also obviously a much more compassionate way to live. It's a more sustainable way to live when you look at the impact of animal agriculture on the environment. And it also will shift your consciousness. You know, once you start to clean up your diet and start eating plant-based foods close to their natural state, there is a clarity of thought and a perspective shift that will occur that I think will help you tap into your heart and your true life purpose. And that's sort of what we speak to and what we advocate.
Talking about vegan nutrition, it's like many people still consider it as very complicated or even dangerous. And I always hear this when I communicate with other people that, okay, it's okay for adults, but Jesus, don't give your kids this food, right? So you seem to be the best example with your family that this is wrong. So how are your kids are really saying about it? Did they ever wanted to eat meat or wanted to make another different nutrition than you do?
Mm-hmm.
Because I think in school and wherever it must be pretty complicated to live vegan, or?
Yes, I mean, I think that first of all, in very young years, it's the greatest opportunity to establish healthy eating habits. And we can see the child obesity rates in our culture are skyrocketing, and the diseases and the imbalances in the children. So there is a direct correlation between processed foods and polluted foods or meat that's been injected with antibiotics affecting the systems of the children. So all we're advocating is eating closer to Mother Nature. So we advocate whole foods, whole plant-based foods, as close to their natural state as possible. And it's a process, but I have seen and experienced by really focusing in the kitchen and really making creative meals and having fresh, alive, vibrant foods available coming out of the kitchen, the children have shifted into this way of eating, and they're thriving on it. It's
cool.
Suiting them very well.
Yeah, cool, mm-hmm. Great. Imagine, I told you already, when I read your book, I did not only start immediately in the kitchen with one of your smoothies and with one of these energy bars. I tried it. It's still in my fridge. I also bought a CD meditation for beginners. So it's not only a cookbook, it's all, as you said, as a sort of an inspirational meditation book as well.
Mm-hmm.
I always wanted to do that, but never took the time for it, and you engaged me to it finally. So what does meditation mean for you both in your life?
Mm-hmm.
Well, I think that meditation is essential. You know, I think that part of living more fully and more authentically requires that you connect with yourself more deeply. And I feel like in our modern culture, everything is very rushed. We're distracted. We're looking at our phones. We're always late for the next appointment, or we're stuck in traffic, and we're never really present in the world or with ourselves. And so, you know, part of our message really is, in going back to plant-based foods close to their natural state, it's also a return to your own natural state. And in order to do that, you really have to take the time and make the time to connect with your heart space. And that's how I think you can reset your trajectory and really get perspective and objectivity on your life. And the worst case scenario is you're not so reactive during your day. You're more contemplative, and you're more you have an objective clarity about why you're making the decisions that you're making. And I think that's important. And I think that, you know, in terms of like the lifestyle aspect of the book itself, part of what we wanted to do was to show that this lifestyle is not like, just because we're meditating and eating vegan doesn't mean that we're living in a commune, you know, in 1965. Like, we live modern lives. We are very much in the world, and our children are in the world, and we're navigating the world in a very modern way. And I think that this lifestyle is aspirational. We wanted to put an aspirational, modern sort of take on it, so that people can understand that this is, you don't have to be a hippie with dreadlocks, you know, to be vegan, that this is something that we can all do and access in order to achieve better health and live more sustainably, like I was saying earlier.
Yeah, and I would add that eating plant-based foods is really the first step in beginning to know yourself, because it's an opportunity to clear away density or fog that has been confusing you or disorienting you. And you will find, as you eat more healthy, vibrant foods, you will start to reconnect to yourself, to find the things that you love to do as a child. And, you know, we really know that each being and each person was created in a divine essence, in perfection, for a specific purpose. But the problem is, we're so externally focused in eating all these toxins, we can't feel ourselves. So by really embracing a plant-based diet, you can begin to reconnect with your true essence. And really, that's what we need for a truly harmonious and well-planned world, because nature always does it perfectly.
I will inform you about my improvement if they happen. In the book, you describe three types of lifestyles.
Mm-hmm.
It's lotus, herbivore, and phoenix. And you recommend special recipes for each one of them.
Yes.
So could you explain the meanings of these three lifestyles? And could you
mm-hmm.
also say, where are you both living in which lifestyle?
Yeah,
yeah. So the three lifestyles were designed as kind of a model or a guide or a portal where somebody could enter this lifestyle with wherever they're identifying in their personality at this point in their life. So of course we have performance, which is the athletic aspect of how Rich entered the lifestyle. Someone who wants to really be the best that they can physically and perform at a higher level. These are people that are of course very engaged in fitness. They spend a lot of time, you know, exercising and training. And so what we did is we went through the book and we identified the recipes in the book that fit that lifestyle. The next lifestyle is vitality. So that would be more what I came into it for. So it's all about energy. So food is energy. So every single food has an energetic quality, and you're looking for the subtle energetic so that you can meditate and you can live a very peaceful life.
Balance.
So that's what, you know, that lifestyle is about. And then the third one is transformation. And we purposely didn't want to call it weight loss because Rich and I don't use scales. We don't advocate somebody weighing themselves or counting calories.
Yeah.
But if you want to transform and you're looking for a complete, you know, complete sort of rebirth, you're going to want to cut out oils and nuts and some, you know, other fats that maybe somebody on a performance plan would be eating more of those. So we offer these three lifestyles as these portals, But the truth of the matter is we're all experiencing all three. So they kind of go in a circle. So if you enter the plant power way through performance, you're certainly going to experience vitality, and you will also be transformed. If you
come in for transformation,
you will also experience performance, and you will be vital.
Yeah.
So you see, it's all together. So there's no wrong way to enter. Where you just enter where it's most comfortable, and you'll experience a whole full life experience.
Mm. So it's just a hint for people a little bit to start into one way and go all the other ways together.
Yeah.
So you try to avoid the word vegan. So especially it's like a paleo diet and a vegan diet and these the classified stuff. You chose to use the word plant power way.
Mm-hmm.
Yes. Why did you do that? Why don't you really like these probably
vegan
movement?
It's not that I don't like the word vegan. I have no problem
with
the word vegan, and you know, vegan. It is vegan by its very essence, because there are no animal products in any of the recipes. But I think at the same time, a lot of people like this book is written more for the non-vegans than for the vegans. There are plenty of vegan cookbooks out there, and what we're interested in is sort of magnetizing people who are perhaps in most need of a lifestyle shift. And I think that the word vegan sometimes comes with a lot of connotations that certain people are like afraid of, or it creates a barrier because they think, oh, vegan means somebody who is out in front, throwing blood on the window of a boutique in Paris or New York, or somebody who's an angry protester. There are many different types of vegans, but I think the word vegan has been politicized to such an extent that certain people who might not share those politics, but could benefit from the lifestyle, would be prevented from giving it a try because of the terminology. So we wanted to sort of dispense with the terminology, or perhaps attach a new word that's a little bit more neutral, and that might make it easier for somebody to take that first step and provide that like very comfortable welcome mat.
It's not
just
labeled and not so.
Yes, and
by
you know, and also we designed the book. The book was created for everyone. It wasn't just created for vegans. It's created for everyone. So it doesn't matter how you're eating. If you're a pescatarian, or you're eating meat, or you're paleo, the Plant Power Way is still for you. Because all you have to do is incorporate some of these plant-based meals into your already lifestyle, and you will experience the benefits.
Okay. Last year, I also met Brandon Brazier, who's a neighbor of you, as I just heard. And what I really like about his book, who was a very big influence to me too, and your book, is that you don't consider it as a diet, but more such a thing as a philosophy.
Mm-hmm.
And it's like the problem with the diet is, You change something temporarily, but not constantly. So, and if you want to change yourself succeedingly constantly, then you to succeed in the end, then you have to bring it into your life the whole time as if it was normal.
Mm-hmm.
Right?
Yeah, and I think it's a process. You know, it's not black and white. And this is another thing that we wanted to make very apparent in the book is it's a process. It's different for each individual, and it doesn't matter where you are in your process. We still have the door open, and we welcome you in. So it doesn't mean that if you step into the Plant Power Way, you have to draw a line and stop eating meat all from tomorrow, you know, or you have to get rid of all the animal products in your life. But it's a way to come in and to be comfortable in the lifestyle, and to really start living it. And every meal, you have the opportunity to make the higher choice, or this choice into a more conscious way of living. But it can happen at every meal time.
Yeah.
And the decision is made over and over and over again throughout your life. So it's a process.
Okay.
And it's changing all the time.
So Rich, as we can read in Finding Ultra, it's been a long and hard way to transform the way you did, and in the podcast, The One You Feed, that I really like to listen to, you talk about the lows in your life in a very personal way, and which was very impressive to listen to, in my opinion. It's been pretty much of a warrior's path, you said, over there.
Mm-hmm.
And can you tell us about how you manage these periods, and a little about your lows in your life that you had?
Well, I think the lows in your life are really the moments that really define your character, the choices that you make when things are not going your way. And certainly, you know, I've had plenty of lows in my life, and we have, you know, worked very hard and really risked everything to be sitting with you today, quite frankly. You know, I was living a very different life not that long ago, and, you know, I've gone through my turmoils with drug and alcohol addiction that have taken me to some very dark places. But because I was able to get sober, I think that I was able to understand that, you know, the power of change and that we really can change. You know, it's a very kind of pessimistic cultural view that we have to say, oh, people don't change. You know, no one really changes. But because I had changed so dramatically in getting sober, I know that that potential exists not only within myself, but within so many other people. And so when I made the switch to eating plant-based and decided that I wanted to tackle these challenges, you know, that was a process of letting go of my old career, which was being a lawyer, where I had a somewhat stable income for some period of time. And then, you know, income became very up and down, and there were very precarious times for my family, and I'm not the only one affected. We have children, and you know, as I was chasing this endurance goal, there was a lot of moments of thinking, this is crazy, why am I doing this? And I'm bringing my whole family into this equation. I don't know where this is leading, but something in my heart told me that this was the path that I needed to blaze. But it was very frightening, and there were some very scary times in that. But I think those moments are what define you, in the sense that, you know, you are required to not only tap into a very deep place within yourself, but to find faith that there is something beyond it, that there is something propelling you forward towards a life of greater purpose and meaning. You know, and so to be sitting with you here today, and to be at the Frankfurt Book Fair, and to have, you know, this second book out in German translation, I could have never foreseen these things. You know, when I was out riding my bike and we were broke and I had to, you know, go into a garbage can and eat old food because I didn't have any money, you know, I could not have foreseen that something like this was possible. But I think even in that dark moment, I had the faith that this path was leading in a certain direction. And so I think the message in all of that is to, you know, find that thing within yourself that is moving you, and to pay attention to it, because I think in our culture, you know, we're sort of told, oh, don't listen to that, you know, here, you need to get on with your life and do the responsible thing. And we kind of quell, you know, that sound within us that is yearning to be more fully expressed. And our call to action is to cultivate that, to listen to that, and to bring it more into the surface and make it more fully expressed.
Is life more intense in the high or the low periods?
That's an interesting question.
Yeah,
I think it's more intense in the low periods, I would say.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Everything becomes very hyper focused, and you're forced to be, when the moments are very low and you don't know what's going to happen, you are very present. You're very like in the moment of what's going to happen.
Yeah, and I would say that in those moments, that's where you're. Connection to something outside of yourself is calling you, and you have the opportunity to connect in a very meaningful, deep way in those times.
Yeah, Julie calls it your divine moment. She says, I wish everybody to have their divine moment. You know, that moment where when it's happening, you think this is the worst thing ever. It could not be worse than this. And yet, 5 years later, you look back on that and say, thank God that happened. That was amazing. You know,
yeah.
That is what really set the stage for me to now be doing all these other things.
Okay. Some people, nevertheless, may look at your life and say, oh my God, from one extreme to the other,
yeah.
and from one addiction to the other.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what I heard about it when I read Finding Ultra and posted it on Facebook, hey, this is great, and you have to read it. And all people said, reacted like, oh, what do I see there? A guy who was an alcoholic and now he's addicted to running. And
yeah.
Do you care about this, or do you say, okay, well, let them talk?
I think
or is it really a little bit addictive, this ultra endurance?
Yeah,
sport?
It's a fair question. I can't you know, be angry at somebody for having that perspective on that. And I think that it's important to raise that and for me to look at it and say, yes, I'm a recovering alcoholic, and I do have this addictive personality, and now I'm training for these crazy races. Of course, You know, the person who is naturally of an addictive personality will be attracted to that, you know. So there is, of course, that aspect to it. But I think the distinguishing line, the difference, is that, you know, using drugs and drinking was always the easy choice. It was always the way out. And as you know, getting up early in the morning to do the training, that's difficult. That's difficult. And I found that by devoting myself towards, you know, that challenge was an opportunity to not only learn more about myself, but to cultivate a better version of myself, not only for myself, but for my family. And that's been my experience. My experience has been that it has bettered me. Now, that at the same time, it's important to find an approach to it that is balanced. And my life is not always completely in balance. It vacillates from being out of balance in certain areas and then swinging back into, you know, a different out of balance. In the macro, it looks very balanced. But I'm somebody who likes to focus on one thing very intently and then shift my focus onto something else. And I don't necessarily think that that's wrong or bad.
Yeah, I guess it's all about finding the right balance, right?
Yeah.
So you seem to have found it so far. Very good. Rich, you did 5 Ironmans in less than 7 days and described as very impressive in finding ultra. And some weeks ago, I saw you running in the internet with a guy who's even more crazier than you were. I think it was Utah with James Lawrence, who did 50 Ironmans in 50 states in 50 days. And he's called the Iron Cowboy. Wouldn't Crazy Horse be a better name for him? Like, so
yeah.
How crazy must someone be to do these things that you both did?
I think it's fantastic and phenomenal. You know, I think that's what the human spirit is all about. Is that any crazier than the first guys who said we're going to go to the moon? You know, isn't this what is so amazing about human beings, that we dare to dream and aspire to things that other people say are impossible? You know, when we set out to do 5 Ironmans on 5 Hawaiian Islands, people said nobody could do that. That's crazy. And certainly, you know, people said James Lawrence would never be able to do 50 Ironmans in 50 states in 50 days. And I certainly doubted whether he would be able to do it.
Me too.
But I was also the first guy there in Utah on the final day to celebrate with him. And to you know, give him a hug and give him a high five, because I get like emotional even thinking about it. What an amazing thing that he just decided this is what he was going to do, and everybody told him he couldn't do it, and he went out and did it anyway, and he brought his family with him, and that is inspiring to millions of people all over the world, and so God bless him.
Yeah, he did it also for a good purpose, like fighting obesity with the kids, right? So. You, James, and also ultra runner Scott Jurek, who just made a new time record on the Appalachian Trail, you all use social media very much to let others take part in your life. Facebook, Twitter, Instagram.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know if you're on Snapchat. Is it curse or blessing?
It can be both. It can be both. I think that you know, it goes back to the conversation about balance, I think. You know, certainly you can be out of balance with social media, and I've been in that place. So for me, it's all about trying to have a healthy relationship with it. Certainly, I want to be able to share these amazing adventures that we're so privileged to have, the fact that we get to travel and go to these amazing places, and I want to be able to tell that story in a way that's relatable and inspiring to people out there. But, you know, you can easily get caught up in, you know, how many people liked your photo and, you know, the pressure to always be, you know, sharing, like, what am I doing now? I need to update this and that. And as somebody who's naturally addictive, like, I can get into that place. So it's important for me, and Julie's always a great, you know, sort of reminder, like, hey, why don't you take a break from that? You know, a little social media detox wouldn't be so bad. And, you know, I look at Scott Jurek, and he seems to have a very healthy relationship with it, because he's not posting all the time. He posts, you know, like, very... When he posts, it's important, but it's not like, you know, multiple times a day, you know, and I think that's a good approach.
Julie, I heard a great sentence from you in the podcast, the one you feed, the power is in the moment, and believing this way keeps one moving and changing. It's our own decision to give a moment, every moment, a positive or a negative energy. And could you explain this a little deeper, and how is meditation probably helping on finding the right way to focus at the moment?
Yeah, For me, I really, really feel that the power of us to experience life is with the perspective that we give. And when we understand that we have the power in each moment to shift our perspective or to choose a perspective, it can shape your entire life. And so that can be cultivated through, for me, it was practicing a lot of yoga, a lot of asana, and actually doing the physical postures that is connected to the breath. And it's the connection to the breath that starts to expand and give you this other attention where you almost feel as if there's a part of you that's watching you do the practice. So you're not even really the practice. And it's this kind of second attention that is very helpful. You may feel it when you get in the zone, when you're running, that kind of moment. But it's really taking a moment and feeling the breath. Taking all of your energy and really feeling, like we were talking last night, if you just did an experiment and you took all of your consciousness and put it into your hand, you would start to feel this sort of expanded experience of life. And I think it frees us also of our stories that we like to create about ourselves. Like often people will create a story of misery for their life, and they'll start early in childhood. I was adopted. No one picked me for the soccer team. I'm unlucky, right?
Yeah.
And they start
yeah.
to weave a chain of experience, which is in fact insane because there are millions of moments that have happened over their entire life. And with a different perspective, they could have simply chosen a different chain. So with the power of the present moment and yoga and meditation, it's cultivating to get us to connect to the energy that is behind what is going on in the personality or the mind. And so that is what I mean about the power of now, and that's why we can be reborn in each moment with the choices we make, also in a plant-based way, and also you can leave all of your history behind by connecting in the moment and accessing this other a part of yourself, which is the same for all human beings, all sentient beings, and it is constant and never changing.
Next is a question. I think I know the answer already after this interview, but you can explain it a bit more. It's like when I got vegan, it was 100% an ethical thing. I didn't know at all what I was eating and what was in there, if it was healthy or not. I didn't really care. I just don't wanted to hurt animals anymore.
Mm-hmm.
And that was the first thing about it. Then I started running and thinking about, okay, I have to do something with my nutrition and everything. So I'm convinced that it's not only healthy, but also increasing my performance. Is there such a thing as energy of foods?
Absolutely. Absolutely. Every food carries with it potential energy for the body, right? That's what we're eating food for, and the quality of that potential energy, shifts and depends upon what foods that you're eating. So you know very well that if you're eating very low vibrational foods or foods that have a very low nutritional density, that you're not going to feel so good. If you eat a big pizza or a loaf of bread, your run is probably not going to feel as good, you know, if you ate a green smoothie of kale and hemp seeds and berries, right? So, of course, these things are true. So eat, just because you're eating vegan, non-animal products, doesn't necessarily mean that you're eating healthy.
Yeah, absolutely.
And for us, in the kind of the plant power way, is about eating the most nutritionally dense foods possible. And that goes to again, going back to eating foods close to their natural state. As the vegan movement continues to grow, there's more and more kind of vegan alternatives to animal-based product foods, like all kinds of ice creams and meat analogs, fake meats and things like that. Not all of those are so healthy. Certainly they're more ethical or more compassionate towards our animal friends, but not necessarily of the highest vibration in terms of health.
Yeah, that's the nutrition that another guy who's here at the book fair, Patrick Baboumian, probably
mm-hmm.
chose a little bit. He's absolutely different. He's a strength athlete, you're an endurance athlete, and I think it's pretty easy to eat unhealthy as a vegan.
Mm-hmm.
I think most vegans do it without knowing it.
Mm-hmm.
So you give a good choice, with the book you give a good handout for people just to change a little bit.
Mm-hmm.
So coming to an end, what is What are your plans for the future? We just talked about yesterday. You showed us some pictures of your proudly released new books, a new book, Nut Cheese.
Yes.
Is a working title for it.
Yes.
So this is one thing that you're working on.
Yes,
what
I'm working on a Nut Cheese book, and also tied into animal compassion, sort of in a sort of larger context, and also on the water usage. That is taken from the dairy industry and the meat industry. I'm also working on a birthday cake book of vegan, gluten-free birthday cakes, also included with parenting advice. I've been a mother for 20 years now of 4 kids, and I'm playing a band with my sons. So I have a lot to share about our life and the creative way that we interact as mother and children together. So I'm excited about that. And then I'm writing my Finding Ultra, my memoir now. So those are a few things that I'm working on. I'm also studying sitar. So
yeah.
It's my next musical expression. So I brought it with me on
this trip.
You're
on a good way, I tell you.
Yeah. Oh, thank you. Thanks so much.
Rich.
So I'm also working on a new book, which is kind of a holistic approach to health, mind, body, and spirit that's informed by my podcast. I have a weekly podcast show that I do that you can find on iTunes or anywhere on the internet on my website, where I do long-form interviews with inspiring people across a broad spectrum of categories, generally people that inspire me and a lot of people that are in the health space. And that's been very successful. So it's continuing to grow that audience. We're closing in on almost 10 million downloads,
mm-hmm.
Which is amazing.
Yeah.
And so this book will really be kind of crystallizing a lot of the wisdom from so many of my guests and putting it into a book form to be informative to people out there with tools to transform your life. So beyond that, a lot of travel and a lot of speaking engagements. I'm going to Beirut, Lebanon in a couple weeks to run the marathon there and continue to travel. And, you know, really our goal is to affect millions of people and help them access healthier lives and a more authentic experience here in our short time on planet Earth.
And transform a little bit.
Yeah, transform a little bit, sure.
So you're not competing this much anymore. You didn't make a competition for 4 years, you told.
Yeah, not this year.
Mm-hmm. So don't you miss it a little bit, challenging yourself?
Yeah, I do. I mean, I still train to the best of my ability every day that I can. It gets a little tricky with the travel and everything, but I haven't competed in a couple of years. I still feel like there are things that I can do in the endurance world that remain unexpressed or underexpressed. I turn 50 next year, so maybe that's a good opportunity to take on a new challenge, and I'm starting to think about maybe what that might look like, but nothing concrete yet.
You know, 50 will be the second midlife crisis.
Yes,
you know,
exactly. Well, it'll be 10 years, so now I need to, what's the next thing going to be, right?
I just read an article which was really funny about from a guy who said when men become 40 years old, it's a midlife crisis, and they either leave their wife or they do become vegan and start running marathons.
Right.
That's what you also already experienced. So great. I'm curious about what happens in your second midlife
I'll
crisis.
Let you know. I'll come back and let you know.
I'm looking forward for your new books and your new music. So, and thanks for having you here and for joining me, giving me the time to make an interview with you. And for running with me this morning,
it was
great. It was a pleasure.
Thank you so much, John.
Thank you.
Thank you.